So to begin with our third session, I would invite our Dr. Jenin Patel to invite to initiate the session. To begin with the session, please unmute the mic and switch on your camera. Over to you, doctor.
She's just coming in.
Dr.
Dr.
Jenin.
Janin? Yeah.
Isn't she supposed to be there already?
Hi, good morning, everybody.
Good morning, doctor.
Yeah. So are we good to start the session?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So in the introduction, the whole idea of this course would be that normally when we have a complicated case, we are well prepared for going ahead and we have our preoperative setup ready and the skill sets ready that we need to take up a case. But sometimes we do face problems in which we are not ready, and how we go ahead and face the storm for favorable outcomes is what we would like to be discussing, especially when we are dealing with capsular bag dilemmas. Because for a, it's a prerequisite for any premium IOL and favorable outcomes to have an intact capsular bag gum, whether it is with your CCC or whether it's posterior end or an absence of a capsular bag completely. So this course takes up to dealing with the storm from the first step to the last step and challenging cases to come over
okay.
Stumbling blocks, make them.
So I have one question.
So we would
Jenny,
start.
I have one question. Yeah, one question. How do we know how many people are watching us?
At the moment, let's start the course because we'll run short of time.
No, because there must, because this is a Zoom, so there is a metric which tells us exactly how many people are watching, and maybe Samriddhi can tell us this.
Saris, nobody will know because it's being webcast through the AIS portal, so you will not know how many people
all
are
right watching. So there is no counter like that.
No,
all
no,
right,
because there are 4,000 attendees, right. And you don't know how many are in each hall.
All
okay.
Right. All
so
right.
We'll start with the first talk with Parul Sharma, which is CCC and its challenges. Parul, you're good to start?
She's rejoining right now. She had to go into the system preferences and do it. So she's rejoining right away.
Okay. So Abhijit, you want to take your talk first?
I don't mind.
Yeah. So I think we can take your talk first, which is dealing with the intraoperative complication of zonular dialysis.
And how much time each speaker?
Each speaker, we've given 10 minutes, sir.
Okay, ma'am.
So, these are one of the cases that I have realized that when you're in a busy OPD and you've not dilated and checked and you get these kind of patients on table. So, here you are having zonular dialysis here as well as here. So, they're around 3 clock hours on either side diametrically. So, in this case, I'm going to remove off a piece of a pie of the nucleus so that I have space in the bag to put in the CTR. And in this case, I'm going to put in the CTR before I start my phacoemulsification. So I have made that space there. And from that, I'm going to put in the CTR. I believe that if you do it at this stage, the CTR actually goes at the equator and it doesn't trap the cortical matter behind the CTR itself. So that's the manual way of putting in the CTR. And then I use a Sinsky hook to actually take the CTR below the capsule and just tap it so that it goes in place. So that's a blunt iris repositor, which I go below, and I'm making sure that I'm below the capsule so that it doesn't hamper my CCC. And once you can see the ease with which the cortical matter comes off when you're doing this at this stage. Once you've done that, I'm going to put in a three-piece IOL in the bag, and I'm going to try to keep it in the, it's going to open in the direction of the zonular dialysis. This is another case which I was doing a refractive lens exchange for a high hypermetrope. And now if you see, the bag is moving in that area and there is some amount of zonular dialysis here. So in all my premium cases, if I feel that the bag is moving while I'm doing the polishing, I would actually put in a CTR without fail in all these cases. So a major thing for me during these cases is the polishing. And here you can see again that there's a particular area which is having the zonular weakness. This is a preloaded CTR, which is by biotech, and it goes in pretty smoothly. So in this case, when you're unlocking the trailing eye, you need to actually lift it up a bit. This was one of my first few cases with Centurion. I usually put the IOL under saline. It's a toric IOL. This was way before Verion. And the patient just squeezed the eye when I was at the, when the IOL went in, and I had a zonular dialysis nearly 4 to 5 clock hours, and the IOL was already there in the bag. So in this case, again, I had to put in a CTR, but in this case, the CTR, I started putting it towards the zonular dialysis first. Now, there was a problem here because if you can see, the CTR is actually coming in front of the iris. The entire bag is in front of the iris. So here you have to be careful with the location of your bag. And at times just see to it that it goes behind, because once the CTR is in, it would be very difficult to put the bag in behind the iris at that stage. And once the CTR is in, you can just do a good vitrectomy. These were the old times when I never used to use a tricot for staining the vitreous. But there are other ways and means of knowing that you've done a complete good vitrectomy. And once the vitrectomy is done, you dial the IOL in the player axis that you want to place, and you can just come out, and that gives you a good this one. Now, this is also a pre-existing subluxation. But here we are using the flax to actually recenter the rexus. That's the most important part in the flax. Apart from that, I don't think it would make any difference manually. So I had an option of putting a CONE or a CTR or iris hook. So I went with the capsular hooks here, and I supported my the entire nucleus back. And I've done the hydro dissection there. Now I had an option of putting in the CTR at this stage or actually going ahead with phaco. But then I thought that my bag was pretty stable, and I went ahead with the phaco emulsification, which was a piece of cake, because with the wedges already made by the flax, it didn't trouble me too much. So once this was done, there was an option of now deciding whether I have to do a CTR now, or whether I put an ASI anchor, or whether I put an MN segment. So here I decided I would put in a CONE here. So it gives me the support for the CTR, as well as I would suture it out there on the sclera. So in this case, I have just taken two straight needles with a 10-0 proline, and there is a loop. There's no stitch on the eyelid there. Now here I was going to try to do a Hoffman pocket here. I've removed the capsular hooks here. And unfortunately, while I was doing the Hoffman pocket, it just went through. and I had to abandon the Hoffman pockets then and there. So now the thing was, do I change the site? Do I change the plan? What do I do? So then I decided, okay, let me change the site and do it in a different fashion. So I just opened up the conjunctiva there. I've just made a radial cut after that. And I've made a scleral pocket there. Instead of a scleral pocket at the through the limbus, I've done it on the sclera there. And then with a routine, typical railroad technique, I have put in the two needles. And then the other needle as well. So here I prefer to put it in a radial fashion, not side by side. So the first needle would come behind and the second needle would come above it. And then you take the sutures out from the pocket and tie it so that the sutures are buried there. And you don't need to take any sutures on the flap there at all. And once that is done, you can easily put the IOL in the bag. And it centers pretty well with the support that we have provided for the... Now, a small caution here is to see to it that the eyelet is above the rexus, because otherwise it's really not going to sit there well for the support. So I had a traumatic midriasis also along with it. So I had done a full thing instead of doing a cerclage there. And I could get the pupil down to 4 mm. So a good thing out here is to use the dispersive viscoelastic every time to keep the chamber stable and see to it that the chamber is formed with a dispersive viscoelastic in all such cases. And that really makes your life easy, and it also helps in protecting the endothelium in such a case. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Abhijit, for the lovely presentation. I'd open the to all the panelists. Would anyone wish to take up any questions? Or
yeah, me.
Yes, Cyrus.
Yeah, Abhijit, that was a fab video. Where do you get your Sioni's ring from? Is this upper ring? Who makes it?
Yes, that's the upper ring, and the one, the blue one, the preloaded one, is from Biotech. Yeah.
Yeah, but preloaded Sioni's ring or preloaded just regular CTR?
The preloaded CTR. The Sioni is from Appa.
The Sioni is from Appa. Okay. We have never seen a preloaded Sioni. I don't know.
No, not preloaded Sioni. Even I have not seen.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Yeah. All right. Wonderful. Thanks.
Nice videos, Abhijit. I also liked your preloaded CTR. How much does it cost?
Oh, they're just evaluating it. So this was just for evaluation.
So it's not marketed. Yeah. I think if
I'm using a preloaded CTR from a company called Offtech, which we get in Bombay, luckily. It's a little expensive though. It's like 8,000-9,000 bucks a CTR. Yeah. That's the whole problem.
So this would typically be around 1,000 bucks. That's what they're trying to put it at.
Much better.
Yeah.
Madhu instrument also give a injector, no, for CTR.
Yes.
Instruments.
Yeah. Even Epsilon makes one. I mean, there are several which are available, and the original ones like Duckworth and all and Mosher, they are very good. Others can be very, sometimes unreliable, and they can actually cause complications if they are not absolutely perfect. So
Abhijit, very nice videos. How do you decide on the sizing of the CTR ring? Like which?
So by default, I prefer to have around 13.5, because if there's an overlap, I don't mind. But if there is no overlap, there's something that I wouldn't prefer. So irrespective of whatever, I keep a 13.5 in my theater rather than sizing it on table.
So, do you have anything? They say you make the Hoffman pockets before we open the globe. So what would the panelists believe in this? Like making a Hoffman pocket before opening the globe is much safer than once the globe's open and then go ahead to kind of do a scleral dissection. Could you think that could have been a possibility where you could have felt that the reason of your pocket going wrong could be that?
I don't think so, because
making it pre-starting the case rather than doing it in the middle of the case.
Yes.
Could that have been a possibility?
So I had not decided on the Hoffman pocket. So that Hoffman pocket was a thing that, okay, let me try it in this case because it looks pretty good. But once you fill the chamber with a viscoelastic, it's pretty much tough, tight. So I don't think that should be a problem doing dissecting out the Hoffman pocket.
Maybe the instrument used was wrong. On this, because
yes, Janin, in fact, I wanted to ask him, did it go too superficial? I mean, you said it went through. Did it come out superficial or it went too deep?
No, it went through deep, yeah.
Deep. So, you know, the trick is, I think what Janin said and what you were already doing is to have the chamber tight. And, you know, instead of visco, you can even make it tight as you finish at the end of surgery when you, you know, use BSS to tighten up your wound. Because with visco, what happens is the wound will keep leaking visco out. So it will lose viscoelastic gradually because it's not a sealed wound. Okay. So what you can do is from the side foot with BSS, you can just tighten the globe. The problem is that Hoffman's pocket can be required at any clock hour. So sometimes it's counterintuitive because you're going in a funny direction and then your direction of the blade has to be along the, you know, along the, you know, wall of the eye. So in that sense, you know, supporting the globe nicely as you were already doing. But the most critical thing is to have the correct depth of the, you know, thing. So you can have those pre-calibrated blades which can give you a fixed depth. And they really work well because, you know, then you will not go wrong either too superficial or too deep. And then, of course, the direction has to be right. Otherwise, it is a little tricky, in fact. And what you could have done is you could have made the conjunctival flap right where your Hoffman's pocket went wrong. And you could have still made a superficial flap there and made it through that as well. I mean,
no, it started bleeding at the angle.
Oh, yeah. Then there's
so
no
then
point.
I just gave it up.
But you managed really well because you went just right next to it and finished it. Yeah,
even I felt that was very well managed. Okay, other thing is the choice of material used. Like I do, is there a difference that people would feel on the panel? A 10-0, 9-0, of course, Gore-Tex is very difficult to acquire. But would you prefer a 9-0 to a 10-0 or both would be equally same for anyone else and people open to the panel? What would you all prefer as a choice of material?
Ideally, I would prefer Gore-Tex. Because I have done Gore-Tex with Emmet segments and with double CONEs as well. And that actually is easier to manage with just taking a stitch and you just bury it in a radial incision or a horizontal incision and you just forget about it. And it just incorporates in the tissue very well. And it's again a 7-0, so gives you a good tensile strength as well.
Where do you source it, Abhijit?
I have a person who gives Gore-Tex in Bombay. So they are dealers for the cardiovascular and they actually can give it to us as well.
Right, because, you know, for the audience benefit, if we could share a, you know, source to buy the Gore-Tex, because I get this question all the time and I myself don't have a good source.
If you put it on the Google, you actually have one particular dealer, Sunil, I think, that fellow manages the Gore-Tex in from Bombay.
Perfect. Perfect. That's great.
It's
thanks.
Pretty costly though.
Between the 9-0 and the 10-0, like I want to bring up that because I personally feel the 10-0 is a little fragile and especially when you're dealing with passing it through and doing the railroad and you've done the whole thing and then it breaks, you might tend to have to re-repeat the process. So would a 9-0 be better compared to a 10-0 or everyone feel it really doesn't matter?
Have you seen a 9-0 with a straight needle?
Was that?
Yeah. Are you getting 9-0 with a straight needle?
I am using the straight needle, yes.
Straight needle we are getting. Okay.
I agree, Janin. 9-0 would be better because 10-0 not only during surgery, even later, I think, you know, the its longevity is not great. You know, it tends to, over a few years, you'll have patients come back with, especially if you've kind of tightened it too much and you've had to pull in, especially like a lens coloboma where you put a CTR and you have to stretch it and bring it to the opposite limbus and try to anchor it there. You know, there'll be a constant pressure on it. So in fact, that's why I always put a CTR in the bag as well, because just a segment will also be, you know, still putting pressure on the glow, I mean, on the bag as well. So I think you're right. A thicker suture, 9-0 might be better for sure.
Okay, so we move on to the next talk. And the next talk would be mine, which will be...
Can I excuse myself? I have one more session. I'll join back again. Is that okay?
Yeah, that's it.
Fine, thanks.
So I would be taking
just before you start, Jenin, before you start, can I just check?
Okay, Paral, yes.
I can check my, I just want to see if I can share my screen now. And if
you can
I
take over your talk as well.
Yeah, we can see that.
Perfect. Yeah. So then can I take over now?
Yeah, yeah. Parul, go ahead.
Okay, but what I'll do.
You need to shut your video, your video first.
Okay. So after that very lucrative and advanced thing, we are going back to the little basic, because that's what challenge is. So, you know, it's one of the most important step, one of the most crucial and one of the most delicate, you know, patient. It can result in mishap or loss of stress if properly for the patient. Now, right frame of mind, what do we need? What all should we have on our trolley table to deal with any kind of challenges with dealing with different kind of CCCs? So we definitely need to have micro scissors and forceps. We need to have both dispersive and cohesive viscoelastics. Do keep a pediatric capsular rexus forceps on the side also. You don't know when you'll need it. Make sure that your eyes are of low vitreous pressure. So, you know, these are various eyes you'll get. Many people have glaucoma, many have other issues. And if your vitreous pressure is high during the surgery, it will affect the outcomes of your CCC. Of course, a cool mind. And if you have the luxury of femto laser, it does make your life easier. So before we actually get into cases scenario, let's look at the two different factors of rexus, a good rexus. So when you're going parallelly alongside, then you are sharing between you land up with problem of peripheral extension. So do understand your forces, do understand what direction are you trying to carry on when you're doing your rexus. And for children, it's ripping, which we will of course demonstrate in the videos also. Now, if your anterior surface is complex, which means if your chamber is shallow and your anterior capsule is not flat, this is where how your rexus will, you know, start going into the periphery, even not knowing it. So make sure that the chamber is stable. Another problem is be aware of where your zonules are. The more anterior zonules, what they want to pull on your anterior capsule, the pull on the anterior capsule means the tendency for peripheral extension. So I put here a portfolio case. I enter the hypermature cataract thinking that I'll decrease the intralenticular pressure, but it goes completely on both directions, splitting the capsule. So now what do I do? Okay, this is classical Athenian with a bulging cataract. Try not to disrupt the cortex at this stage now. Get radial tears on the side. So once I've made radial tears on the side, I'm trying to create a little flap, which I can then hold and create a curvy mirror and continuous rexus forceps. You may have to do it multiple times. You will have to do it on both the times. Luckily, this effect has soft, you know, the laceration. Otherwise, you have to be careful of your phacodynamics also. So you do the similar rexus on the other side. Remember, the pull is towards the center. So you are right now ripping the capsule towards the center and not shearing it. So because it's a soft cataract, I could aspirate most of the material out. And when there is an extension, make sure that you go on to the lower phacodynamics mode. You are operating on left and aspiration lower to have a good control and for your rexus not to utter. Now, this is again a hypermature Mogaki. And the moment I put a nick there, there's a lot of cortical matter out there. So hopefully, I'm hoping that there is no extension this time. So I go in with the Simcoe. It's a controlled one, so I use Simcoe. Remove the cortical matter. Now, here, the base is not so strong. So you make sure that you're putting your, you know, cohesive viscoelastic properly. Get the capsule flat because it's Morganian and, you know, the pressure, counter pressure is not so big. And once your rexus has been intact, you have enough confidence to hold the nucleus and go for a direct chop and complete the case. So start with smaller rexes in hypermature kind of cataracts. So that gives you the liberty that you can, you know, keep a good, well capsule bag, and then you can decrease it later. Also, be very careful of where your nick is going. Sometimes a simple rex is like, see, I got a nick here. I didn't bother much about it, you know, and I continued with a regular rexis. I'm feeling okay. Rexis is going fine. Another important thing is when you're doing any rexis with cystitome or rexis, make sure that you're not dipping the posterior wound, you know, not if the visco grows out. And then, so once I finish my FECO, I see that my nick here had caused a rent. And if I was on high fluid dynamics, this could have anytime gone out. So it's important to be out the rexis. So here again, it's a hypermature Morganian. Here, what I'm planning is that I'll do a small rexis. And so we start by inflating the capsule, a small radial nick. Also, what you can do is take the cystitome on. Sorry, that's hospital. So once I finish my smaller rexis, I'm going to go inside, aspirate the intralenticular pressure so that the cortical matter, so that the pressure becomes less. Put the viscoelastics again to form the anterior chamber, get a flat capsule, give a radial nick and start all around. So this is a very safe technique where when you start with a smaller rexis, there's no fear of your, you know, capsule extending or going to the periphery. So, you know, for beginners and for difficult cases, I would urge that aim small and you can always enlarge it later. Here we are using the shearing force, which means you're going parallel. Now see the direction of the cystitome is where you want to go. Keep going in the circle, perfect, you know, linear rexis. So, just take up one or two more scenarios. Now, the pediatric CC is very different because in children, the capsule is you know, very elastic, has a tendency to keep going down. And with the low sterile rigidity and a soft, it's more vitreous pressure. So what you do here, like for example, this case, I like to use microvitreal forceps for cases because cystitome doesn't give that good a hold. And here, if you
I think she got disconnected, Jenin.
Yeah. There's some problem in her network.
We discuss quickly while she tries to join back before we go on to the next talk.
You're muted, Jenin. Please unmute yourself.
Doctors, can we keep the discussion to the end? Otherwise, we'll run out of time.
Yeah, I'm here.
Okay.
If Parul is not back, Jenin, you can start your talk.
I'll start my presentation.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay. We'll take the discussions on later.
He's right about the discussion, but we can do discussions later. Otherwise, we'll run out of time.
One sec. I don't know why it's not.
Yeah, we can see the name.
Yeah, I'll just get the video now. Okay, so this is a routine cataract, like a stage 4 cataract, and with very, very little epinuclear material, which is there. So these are the ones that typically don't have any protection. So when we are doing the phacoemulsification of these type of cataracts, we may tend to have an inadvertent touch of the posterior capsule suddenly because of surge. So what is most important to remember in these cases is to prevent the knee-jerk reaction of withdrawing the probe. Stay calm, stay composed. Make sure you don't let the chamber collapse at any stage. You secure all the nuclear materials over the iris plane. Do an tricot-assisted anterior vitrectomy. Once we have done the tricot-assisted anterior vitrectomy, something that I feel every anterior segment surgeon should know is the use of a pars plana posterior vitrectomy. And the advantage of a pars plana posterior vitrectomy would be that you do not allow the size of the rent to increase. You pull the vitreous back into its normal position or the physiological position. And after having a good vitreous cut off, that means the whole connection between the anterior and the posterior capsule, the vitreous connection is lost. I used a foldable IOL as a scaffold in the bag. Once the IOL is scaffolded to the bag, I have compartmentalized the anterior and the posterior segment and then continued with phacoemulsification to aid the removal of the remaining nuclear materials. So this is a relatively good technique to be learned, especially when you do not want the size of your rent to increase. So I want to have some few key home points that are take home points, especially in this particular video. This is the post picture of the day one of the patient. This is pre and they dilated. So most important is never withdraw your probe in a knee-jerk reaction. Always maintain your chamber with an OVD. Posterior pars plana vitrectomy is must for every surgeon to know, and an IOL scaffold could be used. But sometimes in trying to do the same technique, we may kind of lose the whole essence of the thing, and we also need to know when to stop. So the second video is going to tell us more about when to stop. So we have a rent, and I did think of the same thing. So I did bring the nuclear material back into the iris plane. I secured the nuclear material into the iris plane. I had an option to convert to a ECC or a SICS. I decided to use the scaffold. Two important things. I used a foldable scaffold, but this time I used it in sulcus. So again, a bring home point, which I will come to later, helps to compartmentalize the eye. It prevents the loss of nuclear fragments into the vitreous cavity and also prevents the vitreous from coming to the probe. So this helps you finish your phacoemulsification such that you can get to favorable results. So I continued with the phacoemulsification, and I was having my nuclear pieces where I suddenly felt that there has been some fluid, like you can see the air bubble coming. I had some fluid disturbance that came in, and my scaffold then shifted laterally, and I lost the pieces into the vitreous cavity. This is the time when you know you do not want to go fishing for the pieces. You need to stop, withdraw your probe. You remove the scaffold that has been put, because now you cannot put a single piece into the sulcus. I inspected and saw where the CCC is. And at this point of time, did an tricot-assisted limited anterior vitrectomy, made sure that there is no vitreous stands into the anterior chamber. Use the three-piece in sulcus. At this point, I definitely feel that we should put our three-piece in sulcus and then hand over the case to the vitreoretinal surgeon for the cortical cleanup, which happens later. Now, this Dr. Gaurav is going to cover in detail, but I just wanted to bring home a point. When you have ruptured the bag and you have a small tag, it's better to convert it into a PCCC. And that's more important to stabilize the bag. We are all talking about the bag not going disrupted, so that you want to do premium IOLs and have a lens that is placed in the bag. The important point is use an iris hook, because the visualization now is poor, to see the capsular edge such that you can dial the lens into the bag. So that is the point I wanted to bring home, that just a single iris hook can help you visualize the capsular bag to dial it. But sometimes we could be absolutely unlucky and have a complete loss of the capsular bag. In such a situation also, when we have a complete loss of the capsular bag, I prefer this technique now, and I'm quite liking it, where you just make a scleral tunnel, because you're using a rigid IOL. Mark the zero and the 180 degree. 2 millimeters behind the limbus, just mark two other points. Then you take a 26 number needle and you preload it with the proline, that is the 60 proline. Once that is done, you pass it through and bring the proline out of the main wound like this. The same technique is repeated on the other edge, where you put a preloaded 26 number needle, which is with your proline, and bring the leading part out of the tunnel. Once this is done, you use a PMMA lens, which is with your haptic holes are present, and make a flange of the edge of the PMMA. The advantage of this technique is you are not having any maneuvering inside the eye. All your maneuvers are happening outside, which is relatively stable. And now when you put this lens back into the chamber, it is well supported. So the lens is now dialed back into the eye. Once you are comfortable with the way the lens is positioned, you can tighten the other part of the proline, cut it and make a flange on either side, and have a wonderful fixation. But sometimes you have to expect the unexpected. So this was a case where the patient came to us with a subluxated lens. And what happened is we thought it is probably an haptic broken because the posterior capsule could also be clearly seen. So with the help of iris hooks, we improved our visualization. And post improving the visualization, we realized that the capsule is intact, but the lens is also intact. What came to our surprise was there was a complete zonular dilysis that was present. I tried opening the bag to try to secure this lens so that I could secure it. And this was going to give me an unstable complex. So we explanted the IOL. Once the IOL was explanted, I also had to sacrifice the bag complex. Now, this I did bring up because sometimes you're not ready for this. And in these cases, it is better to go ahead and do the Yamane technique because in this technique, it's Yamane is better because you just need a 3-piece and a 26-gauge or a 27-gauge needle or a 30-gauge wide-bore needle. Take a 3-piece sensor, which I usually keep in stock. And I did externalize the haptic. And
Jenny, this music is from your laptop. You can mute it, actually.
Planchet did a tricot-assisted vitrectomy and had a well-centered IOL. So the whole idea is that you could use each of your stumbling blocks as stepping stones to have favorable outcomes in your cataract surgery. Thank you.
Very nice, okay. Janine.
So we want to take the next speaker and do the discussions later, or we want to have something?
I think we should finish a few talks first, otherwise we'll run out of time. We are already behind schedule.
I thought of the same thing. So I would like to invite the next speaker, and the next speaker would be Dr. Harshul Tak for unstable back complexes and how to deal with the unstable back complexes. I'm sure we don't need to introduce Harshul. Harshul's like an introduction that no one needs. So Harshul, would you start with your talk, please?
Yeah. At the outset, I'd like to thank Dr. Jenin for giving me this opportunity. So I'll be speaking on the unstable capsular bag. As such, Dr. Abhijit has covered like a lot about how to tackle with this. Okay. Can you see my presentation, Jenin?
No, sir.
Actually, your screen is visible. I mean, you have started screen sharing, but we can't see the main PPT screen.
Now you can.
What you can do is, no, we can't see it. What you have to do is you have to again exit and then, you know, open your PPT, go to slideshow and then come out of it and then go to Zoom and then try to share it.
Can you see it now?
No, we can't.
Sir, please stop your video, sir. I think your engagement is very low, sir.
Okay. Can you see the presentation now? The keynote?
No, Harshul.
Harshul, we can't see it.
You can't see?
No, we can't. Have you selected the correct window?
Yeah, it's...
You know, so on your window of your keynote, you go to the slideshow, I mean, start the slideshow, and then, you know, kind of come out of it to Zoom by swiping all four fingers on the keypad. And then on Zoom, then you start sharing. Sometimes this happens.
Harshul, till you said that, can we start another speaker?
Yeah, please.
Yeah, that should be okay. No? So I would like, Gaurav, are you ready for it?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. So we'll invite Dr. Gaurav again, who needs no introduction. for posterior capsular plaques and learning the PCC for the neophytes. And I think this is again one of the techniques which maybe not you are taught in your MS days and not someone would encourage you at your pre-graduate level, but something that every anterior segment surgeon should definitely know.
Thanks, Janin, and you're having a wonderful course and excellent speakers. So I'll just try to do justice to this. Okay, so you know, we've all learned how to polish PC plaques, you know, the conventional way with those sandblasted polishers and everything. So I have been working over the last few years on trying to develop something different. And we can see here that I'm going through the main port with just my infusion port from the bimanual and keeping the fluid on. I'm just kind of gushing fluid, and see, because the fluid is constantly flowing out from the main port. If you do this from the side port, it won't work. But with a, you know, fast flow on your infusion handpiece, you can just go close. You don't need to touch the PC actually. But if you would like to do that, you can do that, because the PC will never break because the fluid is constantly pushing it away. So, and if you have a sandblasted tip, you can also polish it. You can see that the plaque is completely gone. And even if it's not gone completely, it becomes loose, like those small strands. And then you can go and aspirate whatever is left behind. So this is very easy to do for central PC plaques, even in the periphery, or if there's some cortex, which is, you know, stuck in the periphery or equator of the bag, which is not coming out, and you're finding it tough to kind of aspirate it. You can just go there with the infusion on through the main port and run the fluid at a high speed, and you know, it can just clean up everything within seconds. I call it as a hydrojet polish. And now here, you know, similar case, a very high myo with a lot of PC deposits. And one way would be to go and kind of keep, you know, polishing them again. Now here I'm using a sandblasted thing because, you know, I've developed these special bimanual IA systems with Epsilon, which are of a gauge, either of a 23 or a 22 gauge. And from the side port, they kind of seal the side port if you have the right size wounds. But here I'm using it through the main port because I want a lot of flow of fluids. And these are high flow cannulas. And here I'm just polishing the PC and with the fluid running. Now, if you try to do this through the side port and, you know, you're just doing it as a polish, you know, it's not so safe because the fluid is not flowing. When the fluid is flowing really fast, the risk to break the PC is minimal because you will never actually end up kind of catching the PC with the sandblasted thing. So you can see here, it was quite effective. Now, similarly here, another similar video, but a little different. Again, here we've removed some of the cortex here and I have some plaque in the periphery over there. Now you can see that these are my special bimanual handpieces, which are both sandblasted, the infusion and the aspiration, and they're matched to the size of my ports. So if I'm using a 21 gauge or a 22 gauge port, I will have the handpieces matched to that so that there is no fluid escape. My chamber will always be deep and formed, so there's no fluid being wasted. So now here I'm just basically wanting to clean that up, but you can see that as I was trying to clear that up, I was finding it tough because it was very time consuming. Here I go with the main port as I showed you before, and you can see how fast it is. It tends to, if it doesn't go away with the flow of the fast fluid, you can use the sandblasted tip of the cannula and kind of do a double action thing. You can have the fluid flowing and you can have the sand polished handpiece kind of scraping it. The advantage is that if you normally do this with a sandblasted handpiece with no fluid, you will sometimes catch the PC and you'll break it over there. And if it's very friable, it can be very risky. This way, there is almost no risk because it loosens up this thing and it never catches the PC because there's constant flow of fluid. And once you've managed to polish off almost everything, it may not come off completely, but then it becomes very easy to go back and aspirate it very nicely. And you can see here that now I'll just quickly go and remove those. It becomes very easy to manage these once they have been loosened up nicely with the way I showed you. And please go back and try this when you can. And then whatever is left, you can go with the other handpiece. So both my handpieces are sandblasted. You can go and polish where you would like to. And that way, and if you can keep the infusion running and the aspiration running as well, it makes it easier because again, it sets up a flow in the closed chamber and may not be as fast as you do it from the main port, it still works. So coming on to another case here, and something that Janin wanted me to show, I was doing this. So this is the other one here. This is another technique I sometimes use. I call it as nibbling on the PC. You know, sometimes if you've polished and nothing has happened, then you actually want to go and kind of chew on the PC a little bit. It requires a lot of control, and you can gently kind of run the aspiration at just about 5 to 10 millimeters and hold the PC. And then, you know, as you're gently holding the PC, it's almost like kind of nibbling on it. So I call it as nibbling the PC. And you can see here that Of course, if you are not careful, you'll just break the PC. So you don't have to do this if you're not very good with your foot control on the foot pedal. It requires excellent foot control. I'm not in PC polishing mode. I like to do this with my usual settings only for bimanual aspiration. But with very fine control, and if your machine is good, you can actually clean up everything by just, you know, kind of aspirating everything on stuck on the PC. So this is only for those people who feel that they are very proficient in handling PC plugs already, not to be tried by people who are beginner surgeons. And you can clean up almost everything there. Let me show, take you to the end of this video to show that everything got cleaned up completely now. So that's one way of cleaning the PC, call the nibbling the PC. Now here So here, this is a posterior polar kind of peculiar cataract. Let me take you to the part where it becomes important. Now, this is a PC plug which I'm trying to polish after I've done the cataract surgery. And here I'm using an older type of sandblasted cannula, again on the bimanual. You can see here it's a very dense one and it's not easy to polish it. And you can see that while polishing, sometimes you'll create a break, you know, because it was, I was being overzealous and it wasn't ready to come off. So, you know, you can end up having a break, and especially if it is a vitrectomized eye with silicone oil and all, these are very friable, they'll break very easily. And now you have to obviously fill up with viscoelastic, don't over distend, and go in with a micro rexus forceps and convert this. So if there is a plaque and if it's a very friable PC, you have to be careful because they can run away sometimes or break in a very peculiar, irregular way. So go around it, go into the healthier part of the posterior capsule, and then just create it. So I created that primary rexus kind of a thing on the posterior capsule. And then you can, if it's of a right size, you can put in your IOL into the back very easily and it'll settle down nicely there. And you can see the big PC opening over there, but the lens is stable and then you can of course manage. So the trick is to, you know, be confident. I mean, don't let the vitreous come out. I'll just show you more videos which will make things much easier to understand. Now, this is another case where we had a... So often if you're doing bimanual and if you're not careful, sometimes there'll be a sudden surge and you'll have a PC break. So here, let me take you back. Just watch this area. And here, as I was aspirating, now the reason why this happened was, if you'll please concentrate here, I'm trying to aspirate this sub-incisional cortex with this handpiece, which is just being lazy. What I should have been doing is that I should have switched my hands and then this would not have happened, because if I was going from this side, now when I'm going from the wrong side, I will obviously be very close to the PC and then it'll just cause the break there. So I've created a small flap. The problem is that I would like to convert this into a small rexus, but there is cortex sitting right over the break. So unless I get that cortex out of the way, I will not be able to. So I'm not going to switch off the infusion. I don't want vitreous to present. So I will have the chamber stable at all points. And then I will ensure that the, you know, the chamber is always filled. So withdraw the aspiration port, put viscoelastic. And now you can probably see the small break here, but there is cortex sitting on the edge of the break. So unless I remove that little bit of cortex, I will not be able to convert this into a rexus. So I try to debulk some of the cortex and see if I can then have better visualization of the flap so that I can catch hold of it and then convert it into a small rexus. So I've managed to do that. And now let's see how I can go back and try to convert it into a small rexus. Have good visualization. Use a micro rexus forceps. Make sure there is no vitreous. If there is vitreous at this point, you'll have to go back with transnilon and do a small vitrectomy right in the beginning. If you allow the vitreous to keep coming out of this, it'll grow big and it'll just go to the side. So please don't do any aspiration maneuvers at this area while the rent is there or fluctuations in the chamber. Otherwise, you'll end up having a situation. So once you've done that, now I'm going to go back and convert this into a small rexus, as Jenin showed in a previous case. Once you have a perfect rexus, small, it can be as small as this, it can be bigger, it can be, as long as it's smaller than the size of the main rexus, you can still put in a lens into the bag. So here we'll be able to put in a lens into the bag there. I'll just take you to the last part and then position it. Now let's go on to another video where here we have I'm again doing bimanual aspiration and there I catch it. So see that in slow motion. It just takes a second of, you know, being careless or, you know, using, so I'm using low infusion nowadays. So all of us are going towards low infusions. So here again, we can, so now I found it tough to go and do this from the main port. I did not have access. So I'm going from the side port, creating another port, and then I'll go and do this. This is a special new forceps which I've designed, but it, in fact, this here, I'm not being able to do it. This is my old Moria forceps, which was, I've been using for several years. It works really well, but since it did not work, now this is a new one, which we've designed with Epsilon, where you can see through the forceps. It's a micro access forceps. I have no financial interest, but it allows you to see through the forceps and gives you good visualization, and you can convert this. Janine, I'll just go to one last video, which I have 2-3, but I think I'm going to be out of time. Now, this is a pediatric cataract where we had a PC plaque. So let me take you to the point where you wanted me to show the primary rexus on the posterior capsule. So initiating it, you can do it either with a 26 or 30 gauge needle, or you can raise the flap on the posterior capsule under good viscoelastic cover. I tend to use Viscoat. And then you can gently, using a micro rexus forceps, create a small rexus, which is smaller than the size of the main rexus. And you can see that the lens, the capsule can sometimes be friable, as I said, and then you have to go around it. If you go try to go through it, it'll just break somewhere and you'll be left in a situation, because then you'll have to lift another flap. So here you can then kind of complete it. Once you've completed that, you can, if you want to do, if there's no vitreous presentation, you can still carry on. But I like to do a small anterior vitrectomy at that point. Now here we were putting a toric IOL, it's a pediatric cataract. And we were able to put it into the bag, and there it goes. And this is another small situation, and then I'll finish. It's few seconds. Now, this was a PC plaque, and there was no possibility of cleaning it up, and there was no point leaving it there. So you can go back, good viscoelastic, go around the plaque, and be very careful. If you're a little careless, you will end up having a runaway. And then you can do a plaque removal plus a posterior capsule small rexus. So we have a continuous rexus there, and then we can obviously implant the lens into the back. And this is a three-piece lens, so we put this actually in the sulcus, and I'm doing a capture. So that way, if you don't want to put in, if you have a bigger size break in the posterior capsule or a big rexus, sometimes it'll just go through the break if you try to manipulate too much. So here we've captured it. You can see that. So always use a three-piece lens if you're planning to do a capture. In fact, in pediatric cataract, always use a three-piece lens if you can. And you can see the good, two sides on the capture there. And you can even go through the posterior rexus and capture. And then to close the main wound, I'm going to use a supra-incisional pocket and hydrate it. I don't suture most of my pediatric cataracts anymore. And this works pretty well to seal the wounds and allow no astigmatism to develop. And Janine, I think I'll stop. This is my trip and blue test with the seals to check for any leaks. And once you've made sure that there is no leakage, then you can finish the case. I'll stop sharing. Thank you.
Lovely. Thank you so much for all the lovely videos, a lovely talk. I'd now like to invite the next speaker. Harshal, are you ready with your talk?
Let me check, Janine. I'm just sharing. Just see. Can you see my desktop?
Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
We can.
Now?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Thank God. Sorry for this glitch. So I'm speaking on unstable capsular bag. So the strategy for to tackle the unstable capsular bag is always to see how much of zonular weakness is there, and how much zonular dialysis is there. So if we have a zonular dialysis which is less than 4 clock hours, then CTR ring alone can suffice. And if we have a zonular dialysis more than 4 clock hours, then we need to anchor the CTR ring with the sclera, either using a Sioni CTR ring, or we need to use CTR ring along with capsular tension segment and other devices. So this is the capsular tension devices right now, what we have available. So the standard CTR ring is of course made of PMMA. It's a horseshoe shaped device with 2 eyelets. So as we discussed, it comes in 3 sizes. So if in the normal cases, we use 13-11 or the 12-10. If the case is having axial length more than 25-26, it's a high myope, we use 14-12 CTR ring. Henderson CTR ring gives the advantage that the cortical cleaning is easier if we use Henderson CTR ring because of the undulations it has in it. So modified CTR ring is used if we have more than 4 clock hours of zonular dialysis. And CTS is advantageous that to put the CTR or CONE, we need intact anterior capsule margin, and we need that the posterior capsule, there is no tear. But in case we have an anterior capsule tear or a posterior capsule rupture, CTS can be used. So this is the another advantage of capsular tension segment. So the timing of CTR or these devices is very important. So the dictum is that we should use them as late as possible, but as early as needed. So in mild cases, we most of the time we use CTR after we finish off our cortical matter aspiration and phaco. But in severe cases, we need to use them after capsulorhexis. So let's see, this is the case which had more than 4 clock hours of zonular dialysis. As you can see, it's a white cataract. Along with that, the can you see the video, Jenny? Is my video playing?
Yes, yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, okay. So you can see that its capsule was also fibrotic. So another difficulty which was added here. So you need to use this capsulorhexis forceps and micro scissors, that and be careful that you don't put much stress on the zonules as they are already compromised. So I go ahead and use the micro scissors and use a bimanual approach to cut this fibrotic capsule which is there. You need to be careful that you have a good 2 to 3 millimeter of the margin of the capsulorhexis from the equator of the lens, so that you can hook the anti-capsule margin nicely with the capsular hooks. So before starting this case, you need to put capsular hooks to stabilize the lens back complex in the anterior posterior direction. So once I finish doing capsulorhexis, now I make a space with OVD. This is a OVD which I'm making space with, and these are the capsular hooks. So you can use iris hook, but it's better if you use the capsular hook because they are specifically designed for this use. So once you stabilize the entire back complex in the anterior posterior direction, and then you can proceed with the phacoemulsification. It was a softer cataract. So I take off the entire nucleus. And once this capsular bag is empty, you take off the capsular hooks again and put a CTR ring here. If you plan to use a Sioni ring, then you can put a Sioni ring here, but here I'm using a CTR ring. So this is a freehand technique. I'm going through side port incision, and see as the Sioni ring, this CTR ring goes inside, the bag is getting stabilized. So use the Kuglin's hook to guide this CTR ring so that it goes nicely in the capsular bag. See these two eyelets, ideally they should overlap to give better stability to the capsular bag. So now we have a good stability. So I go ahead and do cortical aspiration, whatever is there, clean up the capsular bag. And once I clean up the capsular bag, now it's time to stabilize the capsular bag, this entire complex in the transverse direction. So this is the capsular tension segment. I'm using a 90 proline in this case. So there's an eyelet and a hook which projects above the plane of the this ring, which is almost 120 to 140 degrees long. So this eyelet has to be above the anterior capsulorhexis. So I put it in the capsular bag and the hook is above. Then this is the partial thickness groove which I made, and this is the 30 gauge needle I guess I'm using, and this is a railroad technique as we discussed to take out both the ends of the suture. And once you have taken out the suture and you tie it, so it stabilizes and causes perfect centering of this entire capsular bag. And then you can put the IOL in the capsule bag. This is a single piece IOL which is put in the capsule bag, and it's perfectly centered on the side. So I think with the recent advancement and with all the devices we have with us available, we can get a good centration and stability of the capsule bag in the long term. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Harshal, for this lovely presentation. We'll take up discussion because we want to discuss a few things of Sionis versus ATS post Cyrus's talk and Parul's talk. So I now invite Cyrus Mehta for talking about managing the dislocated IOL back complex. Cyrus, we are happy to see you and the transform Cyrus. Again, Cyrus needs no introduction and for his surgical skills, and now that we know about his determination skills as well. So yes, Cyrus, take over.
Janin, old Cyrus was not too bad either.
I'm sure this is better.
Yeah. So, okay, boys and girls, this is my trademark talk, which I give everywhere. So you get to hear it again. Let's have a look. Can you see my slides?
Yes.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
All right. So it's subluxated lenses and loose zonules. So first case, I don't know if you all have seen this before. This patient was lying actually on her back by a pool and a mango fell on the eye. So, you know, when any patient gets injured on the eye, they go to the GP and the GP gives Ziplocs. So she put Ziplocs 3-4 days, realized vision is not getting any better, it's starting to hurt. So she lands up in the OPD with the IOP of 50, clear cornea, mid-dilated pupil, and the lens sitting halfway in the anterior chamber. So naturally, the angle was shut and IOP was up. So give her some IV mannitol, give her oral Diamox, wait an hour or so, and then get in the eye. So this is what it looked like. So this kind of situation with a blunt trauma, a lot of the zonules get stretched out, some get torn. You can see the whole lens is luxating into the anterior chamber. So you just inflate with viscoelastic, use sharp Rexis forceps. And this is not like a hard cataract case anyway. So you don't need a huge big Rexis. A 5mm Rexis will do the job here because you want enough rim of capsule to engage the capsule with iris hooks or capsule hooks. Do a little bit of hydrodissection, clear a little space there. That's the wave you see going across. Push it down. So now you have a pretty decent cortical cleaving hydrodissection. Now remember in the iris hooks package, 5 hooks come. We always use 4 and we always wonder what the 5th one is for. The 5th one is supposed to go for sub-incisional to push the iris out of the way, which we don't really end up using. But when you're going to use the iris hooks in order to levitate the capsule like this, in this manner, then 5 hooks work better than 4 because it will spread the force at 5 points. And the more points you have holding the lens, the more stable it is. That's why we don't have 4 or 5 zonules and we have hundreds because it's more stable. So now once the nuclear material is out of the eye, you slowly, slowly peel the cortex off from the periphery without disengaging the capsule from the capsule hooks. So you just do a simple INA. It's nothing very complicated. So basically with cases like this, you have to anticipate and you have to plan, you have to keep everything ready. So I always have that CTR from Oftech, which is ready, which is a preloaded CTR. I don't use that PMMA CTR anymore. It's a horrible thing. So here's the Oftech CTR going in the bag. Once you get used to a preloaded CTR like this, which is made of slightly a better quality of PMMA, which is very flexible, it never snags the bag. So in you go like this. None of the other CTRs go in as smoothly as this, and which is why I always use it, even though it's a tad expensive. And in goes the lens into the capsular bag. Everything sat nicely. I didn't feel the need to suture it or do any additional amount of support. I center the lens, check that everything is sitting where it's meant to sit. And that's basically the end of the case. So you can manage a zonular subluxation 360 degrees. A little bit of subluxation with just a CTR. Let's have a look at the next case. So once you have a subluxated lens, should we use a ring segment or should we use an ASIA anchor? We are all used to using these ring segments and you get a very nice ring segment in India, which is called not a Sionis ring segment. It's basically called a Gupta segment from a company called Madhu, which is a nice Indian company. It makes one huge ring segment. Okay, that ring segment is really big and supports the bag. Problem is that if you have a small Rexis, that ring segment won't go inside. It's a huge ring segment. You can use it as a deadly weapon. If you hit somebody with it, they may faint. So, let's have a look at that. So, can you all hear me? Because I muted the volume in the video.
Yeah, we can hear you, sir.
You can hear me now, yeah. So basically, this gives us a perfectly punched out Rexus. Use the catalyst system in this case. This is what the femto laser is meant for, not to do RLEs on people who are 6x6. So use a Helon and push the cortex away and engage the capsule hooks. Capsule hooks are different from iris hooks. They are larger in size and they'll occupy more space in the anterior chamber as well. But they definitely support the eye better. They support the back complex better. And here's your Madhu ring segment, which you simply railroad out of the eye. That's very straightforward, as you've seen all the other videos. And you make two openings and just railroad it out of the eye. I don't do all this Hoffman pockets and all. I'm not a very good surgeon. It's all time consuming and I'm quite lazy. So I just put the suture straight out of the eye and then the suture goes, just bury it under conjunctiva and nothing will happen. Remember that retinal surgeons have been putting sutures like this for years together and nothing ever happens. So what if you have a poor excess with a small rim of capsule? What do you do then? There's just not enough capsular margin to engage a ring segment. Like this case, it went wrong. The femtosecond laser, instead of doing a capsular excess, has ended up doing some perforation marks under the capsule. You can see all the stretched out zonules there in the video. So here you're back to good old fashioned manual capsular excess. And again, I was lazy. I didn't reinflate the bag as much as I should have. Reinflate the anterior chamber. So Rexus ran out. So now I have the unenviable task of having to center a capsular tension ring with a really small margin. The Rexus is run off basically to the equator. You can pull a Rexus back in. You can pull any Rexus back in. It's a myth that once a Rexus runs out, you can't pull it. But then you've got your Rexus just stretched basically to the equator. So in this kind of situation, you need more than a simple ring. So you need something to snag the edge of that capsule. So you can use this PMMA device called the Asia Anchor. This is version one that was there with me lying in my samples box from a few years ago. But now they have a second version, which is like a three-dimensional version. It has like a paper clip with the clip, which is like this. So it snags the capsule better. All that you have to do is just remove the cortex. Remember this again, this is not a cataract case. This is basically like clear lens. You can just suck it out with the eye. Okay? And you snag that remaining rim of capsule with the two ends of the anchor like this, like a claw. And the anchor is connected by a single suture. You don't need two sutures because it has only one suturing hole. So there's no point making two openings in the sclera. I always wonder why people make two openings in the sclera with a Sioni's ring, considering it has one single eyelid to suture from. So it doesn't really make any functional sense. But anyway, then we all do the same thing because we watch one another and we copy the same thing. So it's easier to just have one suture going out of the eye and then pass it through the eyeball and tie it tight. When you inject the lens, inject it on an iris repositor, because if it dislodges this anchor at this point of time, then everything is going to flop into the vitreous. So I think my time is over. Let's not go through. Let's see if there's one more video, which I can spend some time with you all for about 2 minutes more. So can you use the single piece foldable as a capsular tension ring? Yes, you can in some cases. So this is a ectopia lentis patient. Let's fast forward it. So basically you do Rexus, as you've seen, and use capsule hooks and hold the bag up. Inject the capsular tension ring. This is an old video from 5 years ago when I didn't have that lovely preloaded one. And I was still using this horrible piece of technology, which is a ring that you put inside this metal box and then push it out. It's really terrible compared to the ones we get today. But since we didn't have anything better, that's what we were using. So here's the single piece foldable. You can do this with anything. You can use an Alcon lens. I've done it. I've done it with a Rayner. This is a Rayner lens, a Rayner copy, whatever it is. So the needle goes through the barrel of the injector. So the needle is connected to the thread, to the proline, and the proline is connected to the IOL. So again, since you're doing a single point fixation, I don't know why people make two holes in the eye when you can do with one. So you are railroading that. Let's see that again. You're basically railroading this suture out of the eye. And if you don't want to railroad, you can make a pretty educated guess where it's going under the iris. Where else will it go? It will come out behind the iris only. And since it's a straight needle, it comes straight out of the eye. That's connected to the lens. Now inject the lens in behind. So, and this will itself stabilize the capsular bag. In this extreme degree of subluxation, you don't need to use a Sioni's ring because that's a huge, huge big haptic, which is actually as big as your ring segment. So once again, you have to pick and choose your cases. And I don't believe in all this flap making and all. It's a real waste of time. If you have lots of time to waste, it's different. But, you know, I'd rather be doing something else. Play the piano or something rather than spend 45 minutes making flaps. So this will do the job. Just tighten the suture. And suture gets buried into the sclera and doesn't bother you for years later. The patient comes regularly and nothing's wrong with them. So that's the end of the talk. And thank you very much, Jenin, for having me. And great to see you again, Harshul and Parul and Gaurav and Abhijit. I don't know, is Abhijit there?
No, he's not yet joined in.
No, okay.
Okay, so we might be having a discussion. Cyrus, we have a couple of questions for you. So if you don't have anything much doing, then hang on. We just finished Parul's talk, the one that she's left midway. We'll finish that and we'll open it up for questions for everybody.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. So what I'll do, Jenin, is
from where
I'm going live, but in case it starts buffering or something, then we can just go ahead with the discussion. Okay.
Yeah, but I think you start where you stopped.
Can you see my screen now?
Yeah, we can.
Okay, I'll just add a couple of cases. We've seen so much and gained so much. So one urgent opinion I had shown earlier where we were able to, you know, create a rexus. Then there is situations sometimes where you're not able to get one piecemeal rexus. So you have to keep trying, and even if it takes multiple attempts, you try and get the size of the rexus and change the length of a curvilinear rexus, which can in large hold your rexus together. So this video I just put for, you know, early beginners, that when they feel that I'm not able to get it in one go because capsule is not going to behave a certain way, you can take multiple snips trying.
I think we lost her again.
Okay, so I guess let's take it up for discussion.
You wanted to ask me some questions.
10 minutes, yeah. So a couple of things where I would want everyone in the panelists to put in their ideas or say what they think. Is there a difference? When would you want to use Sioni's versus an Asia anchor versus a Emmet segment? Do you all have any particular preference versus the case and only a CTR? And also, would just an IOL, like the three-piece IOL, be good enough? Like you have, say, a one-clocker, two-clocker. Do we believe that a three-piece IOL is good enough just to cause support? So, yeah, I'm opening it up to the panelists. So, take up the answers.
Well, with an extreme subluxation, you can't use just a CTR. It's going to remain subluxed only. So you can only use a CTR when you have like a generalized loose zonule kind of situation. If you have complete ectopia lentis, you can't use a CTR. You have to use either a ring segment. Otherwise, then you have to put in a whole Sioni's ring. And again, putting a whole Sioni's ring is kind of pointless when there's just three or four clock hours of subluxation. You may as well put a segment. It's easier to get in the eye and easier to suture. And you can suture all that stuff outside and then just push it into the eye because you don't get a preloaded ring segment. I don't know why. Somebody should make one. It looks rather straightforward.
Any particular case that you feel you cannot use the anchor and you would want to then look at another section or maybe want to shift your plan of action? Like maybe, okay, the anchor is not... Any particular case where you feel I won't be able to use an anchor in this case?
Yeah. So now I can't use any more anchors because I had only two samples and they are over and I'm not buying anymore. So the thing is that I would only use an anchor when there was no capsular rim left and you had to snag it. So that doesn't really occur regularly to any of us. We all learned how to make rexus long time back. So most of the time, if your rexus is good, then of course, it's better to put that Gupta segment. Nah, it's some few hundred rupees only. Who's going to pay 10,000 bucks for this piece of plastic? Yeah, it's extortion.
Okay. Another thing is, would you, I let Gaurav take this question. Gaurav, would you, for all your pseudo exfoliations, because we know it is a progressive zonulopathy that we are looking at, So would you want to put a CTR for all your cases, or would you still want to just not put a CTR? So what's your take on what you're doing for your pseudo exfoliation cases?
Good question, Jenin. I think, you know, as we're learning more and more about these pseudo exfoliation eyes and people are living longer and longer, I think many of them over 10, 15, 20 years are likely to develop a, you know, a dislocated capsular bag complex. So, you know, the thing is that putting a CTR, if it's a bad pseudo exfoliation, I would love to put in a CTR. Currently, I don't put it in all my patients, but it's a good thought and worth considering. And of course, the only problem is that even if you put in a CTR into pseudo exfoliation, see, they are, these eyes are also more prone to capsular phimosis. So I think that in that sense, having a bigger excess than what you would normally do, like maybe a 0.25 or a 0.5 mm bigger excess with a CTR would definitely help in such cases. I like to do a femto-assisted surgery also with my pseudo-exfoliation cases because I get the rexus of the right size and everything. But if you're thinking about like subluxation or dislocation of the bag, even a CTR would only go to the extent of releasing the forces on the, you know, zonules and the equator. But if it still has to degenerate and the bag has to dislocate, it would still happen with the CTR in place.
Yeah, I agree. But the advantage of then having the CTR would be that if you have a
lens,
you have to pick it up and re-suture with a CTR.
And it won't be a deformed kind of bag with deformed haptics and all, you know, because the CTR will keep the bag shape intact and the haptics of the eye will be in place. So it's very good thought and it's being utilized now because you can just go back and pass your suture through the CTR.
Yeah, and also the CTR would reduce your anterior capsular phimosis also.
Absolutely.
Because there is going to be an equatorial, you know, like a distribution of your forces. So your even your anterior capsular phimosis would be lesser when we use, I think. So we could give it as a thought, like maybe all pseudo exfoliations.
Okay, see, Gaurav and Harshul, more and more I'm looking at this iris retrofixation, iris claw retrofixation as nice and cheap and cheerful. You don't need any fancy suture, segment, nothing. Also, even if the bag falls inside, makes no difference, lens is still there. So would you do an iris retrofixation if you think that in 5 years, this bag is going to fall inside the eye? From now only, we'll do an iris retrofixation and just leave the lens there.
Cyrus, the number of cases where that would happen out of all these patients would be so small. You know, I think if we start doing it, then we'll be doing at least 2-3 retrofixated iris claw lenses every day. And that would be like putting too many people at risk of other things like a CME or a dislocated loop from the iris or so many other things like iridodonesis. So I think...
So Gaurav, will a iris retrofixation still cause CME if the capsule is intact?
So in my, I love doing iris retrofixation. I do quite a bit of it for secondary IOLs and other tight situations, but not where I have a good capsular bag to. I would rather fixate to the sclera. I would do a glued or I would do a SFIOL or something of the kind, rather than support on the iris as a routine. But in tight situations where all that is not possible, you're short on time and the patient is uncooperative, I think a retrofixated iris claw works beautifully well, but should not be your first choice.
What do you think, Harshul?
I think, Janin, what my take is that in mild to moderate, CTR is fine, but if there is severe pseudo exfoliation, I always augment with CTS. No? That takes care of the long-term the problems which can arise because it's a progressive disease. We all know that it's a progressive disease, so we need some anchoring with the sclera in severe cases right from beginning.
Right.
But what do you think, Parul Jain said? Sorry.
Other point that I would want to say for iris fixated, Cyrus, is if we are looking at an iris fixated in a case with an intact capsule and a patient, maybe when a patient has scleromalacia or a thin sclera, or maybe you're seeing that it's already not a very great sclera to start with and you don't want to put your sutures there, then maybe we could think of iris fixated as a choice of lens fixation maybe. I mean, I think that would be the reason why I would think of it.
No, even I'm realizing that I'm going more and more towards iris fixation. It's, you know, it's fast and if handled well, doesn't cause CME. And even that's my go-to. Until unless there is a catch with that and I'm not able to put it. I wanted to ask a question, Harshul. In your video, you showed that you'd put those capsular hook and then you took out the capsular hooks to put the CTR. Like, I would be uncomfortable. Yeah. Is there any particular reason that you chose to do that?
Yeah, because when I'm putting CTR, I want that the fornixes or the equator where the capsule is, it should be free, you know. It should not, hamper those capsular hooks. And moreover, their role is over now. Because whatever anterior posterior support we needed, for doing phacoemulsification, it was all done. So I put a OVD there and put a CTR and then stabilize it and anchor it with the CTS segment. So once their role is over, you can take them out.
Arul, if you're using an MST capsular hook, then it makes sense to remove them before passing the CTR, especially if you're not using the modified new ones, the Osher modification, because otherwise the CTR can pass through the capsular hook. So there I would definitely remove them. But otherwise, as Harshul said, I would remove a couple of them. If I'm after 2-3 hooks, I would remove two of them and leave one there just for the anterior posterior support and then pass the CTR.
Yeah.
But I also tend to remove at least one or two of the capsular hooks and then pass the CTR, but I don't remove all of them. Otherwise, the back can, you know, kind of fall back as well.
It depends from case to case also. No? If
yes.
You feel that,
yes. That's exactly what I just wanted to bring out, that if there's one hook and it's tenting, physiologically, it's not going to be there in the way. You know, the leverage is up.
You can do that.
Really doesn't get into the way and just gives that comfort. And one thing, Gaurav, like, you're excellent. You just kept polishing your PCs one after the other and made them crystal clear. And that's exactly my way, the jet way I do it. Very important to do it from the main port and not the side port to be on the safer side. One thing is that make sure of the quality of your sandblasted. Like, I've burnt my fingers once or twice, you know, not to be too aggressive. There's an old one line, keep checking on that. And wanted to understand your wound closure technique. That was very interesting, the pediatric wound closure which you did. Could you explain that, how you did that?
So what I do is I put the infusion on from the side port with the infusion handpiece so that the eye is nice and tight, and put the infusion on. And then I would just go on the main incision and make a like something like a Wong incision, but Wong incision is done prior to the surgery. Now, this is a supra incisional pocket using a 2.2 a keratome. I just go say about half a millimeter ahead of my wound and make a kind of a pocket inside the roof of the incision. Okay. So it just is extending like maybe. Okay, and then I hydrate that. So it hydrates the stroma on the roof of the incision. And then you don't have to keep struggling on both sides and keep, you know, kind of hydrating them. You just do once and it's sealed. And it doesn't produce any astigmatism. By next day, it's all gone and the wound is nicely sealed. Works very well for side ports also. Like for my pediatric cataracts, if there's a leaky side port, you can do the same thing there rather than try to suture it. But if a child is less than 1 year, sometimes these won't work as effectively. So between 1 to 2 years, up to 1 year, I'll suture them, you know, so...
Interesting. And in your initiation of PCC, do you want to go from center to the side to initiate the, because that's the most crucial thing. Once you have
that,
flat,
yes,
it's good to initiate.
I don't go bang in the center. I start a little off the center and then, you know, just kind of raise it with an MVR mostly. I use an MVR to just tent it up a little bit. And with the same motion, I try to like kind of lift up a flap and then catch it with the forceps. I don't know others how to do it. Yeah.
Gaurav, do you keep your back fully inflated?
No. Just enough to keep it, there, but not fully inflated, no. And then the moment you've lifted the flap, I'll put some Visco to go a little bit under it as well, so that, you know, in the space behind the capsule, I'll just create a little bit of space. Otherwise, you'll catch the vitreous with your forceps.
So there's a Berger space just behind that in the center.
Yes.
So that you
the Berger space, I'll put,
gives you a nice convex.
Put a little bit of Visco into the Berger space. Yes.
Yeah.
Would you prefer a Visco or would you like a dispersive OVD or more of a cohesive OVD?
So in the initial part, I would use Viscoat initially, but towards the end, because Viscoat is more difficult to remove towards the end. But for the first part, I will inject Viscoat. And then if I need to supplement and all, then I'll just do it with methyl cellulose because that will come out faster. I don't use Helon here much because it tends to come out very fast sometimes. I mean, maybe everybody has his own preference, I think.
Okay, a couple of questions to you with CCC. So, are you there?
You have to restrict it to one or two because it's showing time, sir.
Okay, so I think we can, maybe there are people for the next.
Yeah, we can do 1 minute more and then we are over because then 5 minutes to the next course.
Yeah, so Parul, in case you have a CCC and you have a zonular dehiscence where you know that, you know, preoperatively or you don't know it preoperatively, intraoperatively, you feel there is a zonular dehiscence, what would the signs that you would think you want to look for, A? And if you know it's preoperative, where do you want to start your CCC? Away from the dehiscence or near the dehiscence?
No, definitely away from the dehiscence because once I initiate, then my force of vector should be away from the loose area, you know, so that I get a better hold. And depending on what we have discussed so far in the rexes, once I'm discovering that there is a zonular dialysis, so depending on the amount of dialysis, I'm going to choose either a capsular hook or a CTR accordingly. But the use of in the zonular dialysis part, the use of the viscoelastics becomes very important because the capsule is not going to behave in the way we understand it. And the use of microvitreal scissors and forceps becomes extremely important because the cystitome may have the vector forces going centrifugally. So, you know, good anterior chamber, flat anterior capsule completely, and then keeping a microvitreal forceps ready with more of the pull towards the center. So instead of shearing it more, we are, you know, tearing it and bringing it towards center to keep the control. And then of course, using a capsular tension ring or a hook. If small, usually mostly we get away with the capsular hook only with a small dialysis.
One quick question.
Yeah,
Dr. Gaurav.
Yeah.
Have you ever tried reverse optic capture for toric IOL?
Yes, I've done reverse optic captures often. And if you're in a situation where, you know, there is a, you want the optic to be nicely centered and captured and you can't do it in the posterior, this thing, then I will do a reverse anterior capture and it works pretty well, but make sure that, but single piece lenses can be tough to capture that, you know, they may not remain captured for long. And you're lucky if you can capture them, you know, kind of well, and then let it stay like that. But multi-piece lenses are much easier to do an optic capture. But yes, in tight situations, I've done that.
So since I thank you all for participating into the course and for giving in all your valuable inputs with such lovely videos, and each of the videos by each of the participants were lovely. Thank you very much, everybody.
Wonderful.
Thank you, everyone.
Well done, Jenin. Excellent course, and thanks, everybody.
Bye, guys.
Thanks a lot. Bye.